We're going to talk about graphics quality and video lag. Video lag is the big problem in reality games, right? Virtual reality games. That's the big problem, is video lag. Video lag means that your character moves late. You know, you make a control, you move the mouse, and a little bit later, you actually get the motion on your screen. That's video lag. Okay, why do you have video lag? There's two things that cause it. One is being slow, and the other is being last in line. Okay, now with World of Warcraft, if you're playing one of those reality games, you are last in line. You're probably slow too, because that server is probably a lot faster machine than your machine on your desktop and your network that brings that data to you. Okay, so you're probably slow and last in line. But there's not much you can do about the last in line, because that's it. You know, the game's played in a server, you have a computer on your desk, you have to be last in line because it has to compute in the server before it sends the data out to display an image on your screen. With consciousness, it's just the opposite. With consciousness, slow and last in line are still the problems. We can't fix slow. What's slow in this virtual reality? It's us. It's these mechanical, electrochemical bodies and brains we have. That's what's slow. Consciousness is really fast. That's an information system. So we have these slow bodies. So we can't change that, because that's the rule set. The rule set has evolved us, and we have these slow mechanical systems. So what can we do to decrease video lag? We don't have to be last in line. Let's take that body and move it as far up in the chain of events as possible. That will eliminate as much of the video lag as we can. Okay, well, what does that mean? Here will be an optimal design. Okay, we're going to start, of course, in this process of cognition. We're going to start with future probable reality database, because that's where we always start, right? That's in the future. That's what's likely to happen. And we'll look at that future probability, and right away, before we even make a decision what we're going to do next, before we get to the present and our free will, we're going to start that body moving. We're going to get that body underway, because, you know, we're only dealing with 10 to the minus 44 seconds. You know, it's tiny little bit. So we're going to give that body a little head start based on what we probably think will happen. Okay, then after we get the body going, then we actually get to the present where we make a choice. Now, if we don't make the expected choice, that body's going to have to stop moving that direction and go somewhere else, isn't it? But if we make the expected choice, that body then just keeps right on going, and it got a head start on us. Okay. Now, after we make the choice, the next thing that happens is that we generate little c consciousness. We become aware of the fact that we want to move and that we're moving. Okay, so that comes last. Now, this is going to reduce the video lag. Now, very occasionally, we have this problem that the guess is wrong and the adjustments have to be made. And when it does, guess what? We get slow and we get clumsy, because we have to reverse and start and do something else. Okay, that's a rare circumstance, but we generally don't notice it, and very little attention is paid to it, unless we are honing our physical responses right to the peak, like we're an athlete. Okay, we're in Olympic competition. Then we know, you know, you can't interrupt your mental process. You have to stay continuous. What are the consequences? Well, if you're conflicted, fearful, and thus uncertain and tentative, your choices are harder to anticipate, your motion's jerkier, less smooth, less coordinated, and you're clumsy. Athletes must condition and focus, know exactly what they're doing, how they're doing. That's why they practice, to where it's not any longer a mental construct that they're going through. It's just what they do. It's just behavior. It comes right out of the inside of them. It's not something they think. If they have to think about it, they're lost. They need to be doing it on a deeper level than that. Fear, anxiety, doubt, and to a lesser extent, just being disengaged, just being kind of adrift and not plugged in, makes you clumsy. Now, here's an example of that. If you take a board, let's say it's 8 inches wide, you know, a typical plank, and you put it across the floor here, nail it down, make it real steady, everybody in this room could walk across it one end to the other, no problem. Now you take that same board, put it 150 feet in the air, hold it just as steady, and probably about 3/4 of us would fall off before we got to the other side. Why? Fear. Fear makes you clumsy. Fear makes you tentative. You start, you stop, you're not sure, this, that, and you get all out of whack with this system that's trying to anticipate your moving, getting your muscles going in one direction, then reversing it, going the other direction. You get very clumsy. Okay, everybody gets future data just prior to it happening, but not necessarily at the intellectual level. You're getting it at the physiological level, okay, and not far enough in advance to operate on it. These effects were well covered by uncertainty. Nobody really knew about it until not that long ago. They had some very sensitive equipment that could measure little electrochemical potentials at the muscles, okay, in the brain, in the nervous system. They could measure these things, just like the fact that light was a particle and you had this dual particle wave thing. None of that was available to us. We didn't know about that until we got sensitive enough instrumentation that we could see that deep into reality. Well, this works the same way. Okay, so given this video lag problem, one would expect that slow-moving biochemical mechanical processes would be anticipated. Now, an electrochemical process is also an emotional process, right? I mean, hormones get secreted, you know, it has to flow in the blood, this organ gets triggered, you know, slow electromechanical processes. All right, so let's see what happens. Back in the 70s, some German scientists discovered something they called the Bereitschaftspotential. It was a rise in voltage measured by an EEG, but now it was tiny. We think of EEG in alpha, beta, theta states, you know, these are huge. We're talking about things that are probably 3 or 4 orders of magnitude smaller. That's why they were never measured before. They measured these potentials that had to do with muscles, and they found out that muscles begin to move in response to a stimulus before the stimulus is actually received. So they did it in two ways. It was cued and uncued. Now the cued is like ring a bell, and when you hear the bell, raise your right hand, that sort of thing. Well, just before the bell would ring, this very sensitive measurement equipment would see the muscles starting to get ready to move. That's why they called it the readiness potential. Things would secrete, muscles would start to contract, you know, chemicals would change, and the muscle started the process of motion before the bell would ring. Before there was any awareness in the little C consciousness that they were going to move their arm. Okay, it was that sort of thing. So that was one of those scientific mysteries, you know, a lot of people did it and it was confirmed. And the other was uncued, and that means that basically, when it's uncued, you wait until you have this inclination to move. You know, your little C consciousness is aware of it. And when your little C consciousness is aware of it, they found out that they were measuring already that your muscle was aware of it. And a guy named Benjamin, either Libet or Lebe, depending on how French he was, he looked at this and said, that's scientific proof that there's no such thing as free will. Because before you even know that you're going to move, your muscle's moving. So obviously, it's not your consciousness that's in charge. Because your consciousness, well, that was just wrong, wrong, and wrong. He had all the wrong concepts. You know, having this inclination to move has nothing to do with free will. It has to do with selecting from your decision space. You know, and the way they timed it, anyway, it was not good science. But he won an award for it. Because that was science like that idea. You know, science is in this deterministic mode. They like things that are deterministic and absolute like that. So science jumped right on that, and that was the big deal. Matter of fact, the number of papers that had to do with free will shrunk to almost zero after that, because it came very out of fashion to even talk about free will. Only dumb people talked about free will. You know, if you learned, you understood that there was none. That was all an illusion. So anyway, that was like in the 1980s that this happened. But the point is that we see that the body starts to move before the stimulus. Okay? Just what we would expect.